Welcome back, everybody, to the back nine holes of round one of the 2021 Down East Players Cup presented by Eastern Disc Golf and Disc Box. I'm Brian Earhart, joined here again by Nathan Queen. And we're watching you play some disc golf here, Nathan.
Yeah, we've had a little bit of everything on the front. Dan Hastings showing us the way, pretty much. He's played this front nine about as well as you want to. Coming in at five down. Got myself and Taylor Rafalowski with two down, and Scott shooting clean but needs to card a few more birdies, sitting at one down.
So we're going to move into this back nine, and Joel Freeman, he's doing something. Whatever he's doing, it's working, because he's five strokes ahead of everybody else. Let's see if someone can catch him this round.
Yeah, he started off earlier on in the day and started off hot. We've got us moving into hole 10, 528 feet. Another very specific shot you have to throw off of the tee, which is straight. If you can throw it straight, land somewhere right in this area, then you have a fairly short upshot under 200 feet into the green. It should be able to have a pretty easy birdie.
And you have the box after a really nice birdie on number nine. And like you said, it's just got to be straight. There's a long, low ceiling corridor you have to go through.
This is my Star Thunderbird.
Ooh, that one's got some turn on it too.
Yeah, getting a good line on it, able to get up there. That's about the spot. Have that easy upshot.
That is pulled. Was looking to see if he would get a roll bounce, but I didn't quite see it.
Yeah, he kind of stayed right in there on that right side. Not really pinched off, but not in a great position either.
Zeus for Dan. He's going aggressive on this shot. Hard hyzer. It's flipping right.
Yeah.
Missed everything.
Huge flex down that right side and skips up there. He's going to be around 100 feet or so and kind of have a jump putt for the eagle here.
Do not see that one every day. That got through everything and got way down that fairway. And bit of a flippier disc. Is that going to flatten out in time?
Yes, and it just misses that last tree in the middle, which could have kicked him off to the right. He stays in that great position as well. He'll be under 200 feet to the pin. And he's got this up too high and off to the left. Gets a good drop from those trees, though, and he'll be in a good position to save par.
And Scott just had a bland front nine, birdieing the first hole and then eight pars. He's been just so close to scoring well.
He's running it.
Oh, man. Gave it a good run, but this is kind of the position he's found himself in pretty much all round.
Yeah, those long circle one putts. It's not quite what you want when you're looking to get back on track. That's a little closer to where you want it. Taylor putting it inside 20 feet. I'm looking to do the same here.
Nice and soft landing, 10 feet from the basket. That should be a birdie. And this is not common. Long eagle putt.
Eagle.
Get in.
Yeah, he gave it a good run there, actually missing a little bit high right. Hard to get enough power on that, but good aggressive bid.
And yet again, the ninth par in a row for Scott Conway. He's laughing. He knows.
Yeah,
one of those days.
You could tell that putt felt pretty good, and he thought that one was good. Still hit a little bit high. So still looking to get going here. The rest of us trying to tap in the birdies.
And Dan is at six under. He's feeling it right now. He is on fire.
Yeah, not much. a lot of these holes are not easy birdies to get. They're definitely birdieable, but they're not easy to get. So he's definitely on pace for a very hot round if he continues what he's been doing. Here's another par 4, 573 feet. Left to right movement off of the tee. You want to get far enough right, further right than the drone flew right there, so you can have a straight look into this gap. And then speed control is crucial here, as you want to make it over top of this fence but not come flying in too fast and shoot past the basket.
Yeah, very interesting obstacle that I think adds a great element to the hole.
It's a Halo Thunderbird on a hyzer. Gets a good skip over to the left, or over to the right, and that's about where you want to be.
Yeah, that'll give you a pretty straight look at the basket, and potentially with something slower to do exactly what you were talking about. And Dino Dan going with the forehand.
Just getting it around the corner and gets that big skip as well. He'll have a good angle shooting down that gap.
Super clean sidearm.
Just wrist snap and arm movement.
Yeah, just loves that hyzer release. That's beautiful. Is that a little... Is that too far left, or is that in a pretty good spot?
It could be a little bit too far right, but it's...
Too far right, yeah.
I don't believe it was.
And Scott... Needs that to keep going.
Throwing the big shot, trying to get into the gap. Not quite getting there, but he's on that iffy point where there's probably something he can work out. If he was 2 foot closer to that tree, he'd be in a bit more trouble.
And a low sidearm from Dan. Does it have enough? It does, and he sticks it. Another birdie.
Yeah, that was a fantastic shot from Dan. Great control. I didn't want any part of that. Figured I'd pitch it up, try to get a par.
Have you figured out what you were doing yet?
That'll be for Sunday.
Yeah.
And Taylor with a sidearm that looked great the whole way, and he caught that little skinny tree just past the fence. It's going to leave him a pretty difficult putt for birdie now.
Little sidearm from Scott. Gets it over the fence. Puts it inside circle one.
Yeah, and he went inside of that tree there. So tight little touchy forehand. Just misses that last tree by the fence up there. This is my newfound disc this week, a Halo Lion. Been enjoying throwing that the last couple days.
Interesting. I don't think you see a lot of players throwing that disc.
Just look at the rest of my bag and it kind of makes sense.
I understand. A lot of exotic animals in your bag.
And Scott able to capitalize. Not quite in position off the tee, but there's a tricky little forehand up there, able to get the birdie. Taylor with the unfortunate par after throwing a pretty good upshot, just barely catching that little skinny tree, and then Dan's going to go tap in his birdie again to be 7 through 11 now.
And you're making a comeback as well, 3 under, plenty of golf left.
That moves us into our par 5 for the weekend, 868 feet. All this is OB here. If you get right side early, you see these OB line on the left until about this tee pad. OB all on the left side as well. If you can get to that tee pad, you're in a good position to get up and get your second shot somewhere around this area so you can have an approach into yet again another gap to hit. On this very tight green.
This is a brutal hole.
Elevated basket. Yeah, there's lots of stuff that can go wrong here.
And he's going sidearm again. Tight gap.
This is a little soft and gets pretty good lie there from where he could have been at. Scott finally breaking that par streak, getting to two down, and he just throws an incredible backhand turnover controlled shot here to get right into that landing zone in the middle. Great control there.
And they're giving you a lefty hole. They're giving you a little left to right moving shot. You're still going to probably get this to flip up just a bit.
Yeah, I'm going back to that same Star Thunderbird I threw earlier that's got a little bit of stand up to it.
Yeah, look at that. And you're going to have another hyzer around the corner. And this looks fine.
Yeah,
great looking skip.
Yeah, good roll back left there. If it could have rolled off to the right, it could have pinched him off a good bit more. Now he's got a straight look down the fairway.
Another clean looking release from Scott. Starting to find his groove a bit. And
yeah, and he's floated just a little bit long. Kind of a strange angle there. He did avoid the OB that's maybe another 10 feet longer than he landed. Dan having to do a little pitch out, gets a good little leaf redirect and gets him back to the fairway. He's in a good position to get a par from there. And I'm a little blind to this corner, but not too bad, going with that Halo Thunderbird.
And that is exactly what you're looking for. That's fantastic.
Yeah, and there's my little good roll out left. That was also a good roll. Gets me more towards the middle of that gap. So we see Taylor really only do about a step and a half off of the tee. He's got about the same distance to throw right here and just decides to do a standstill and gets up into a great position.
Yeah, he's going to be able to do a step out sidearm from there, which looks to be one of his favorite shots.
And Dan getting aggressive, trying to skip up, and just catches that last tree. Still in good position to get his par from there.
And here we go with another thumber. Scott has some really clean thumber form. Wow, even like the body movement looks like Brian Schweberger.
Yeah, he went with that real low swooping, trying to get it up. He caught some trees up close to the pin and kind of kicked them back down to the left. He'll have a circle's edge or so look from there. We've got a tricky little hyzer here.
And you are parked yet again. Another birdie. That's going to bring you to 4 under par.
Yeah, trying to make a bit of a push on this back nine. Make it look like we're playing the same course as Dan. That scorecard looks a little funny down there.
Yeah, 7 under par, and this is just finally a blemish hole for him, and this is going to be potentially a par.
Yeah, he's probably 100 feet or so again right here, giving it a good jump putt, and catches the cage still. From my watching that in person, I never thought that was high enough to hit anything, and it just stayed up and kept getting higher the whole way. Just goes to what you were talking about earlier with how much power he's got.
Crazy range. Yeah, that was just something I noticed just seeing him, you know, playing tournaments on the road. His practice putting, his putts came out with so much speed, and I was like, How do I do that?
I haven't figured it out.
Maybe one day, Nathan.
Hopefully.
But I guess you don't really need to have tons of range on your putt when you're able to just put them in from 5 feet. Another birdie for you.
Here we are at hole 13, par 4, 513 feet. You've got a gap down the left side and a gap down the right side. The left side leads you straight. The right side is more of a hyzer that leads you to the end of the gap, where you'll end up about right here and have a pitch out. 350 feet or so, maybe a bit longer to get out of the gap. You can choose to lay up with a putter inside or go for a big shot.
And it looks like you got the driver in your hand. And you are going big shot. And big shot it was. That was fantastic.
Yeah, that's that Wraith I've been throwing for quite a while now, able to stand it up and get it on out the gap.
Yeah, I was going
to
say, you made it look like a mid-range coming out of your hand. Taylor's put a pretty good move on this. Does it have enough flip?
This needs to stop.
And
it does stop just in time to stay in bounds. He is right there by the OB line that separates it from the last hole.
Ooh, and kind of a swooping forehand for Dan.
He's turned this over.
Still going.
Way early, but what are trees?
And
it just
nothing.
Keeps on going.
And he's going to have another chip sidearm from there. He's going to be able to throw a slower disc if he wants.
And Scott chooses to go this right side with a very controlled distance. Gets right around that corner and just skips right into the gap.
Wow, textbook. The low ceiling comes into play when you don't make it out of the gap.
Yeah, and he tried to keep that low, kind of got it turned over. I don't know if some wind held it over like that. Or I believe some wind held it over like that.
Oh, boy. That's got to hurt.
Yeah, he said he was going for a skip shot there. And just never really let go of it. And Taylor taking a scary route out over the OB, comes back in bounds, and he's around circle's edge for a birdie look. And Dan will take a par.
And you're only 120 feet away from the basket. That is easy money. Yet another birdie for you.
Taylor able to connect, skipping over into the woods on the left side. Good scramble shot out and a good putt. Three good shots card you a birdie.
Birdie for Scott. He moves to 3 under par. He still has room to put together a pretty good round himself. Still no bogeys. And you move to 5, and you have 14 through 18 remaining. There is plenty of room to put together a scorching round.
Yeah, still trying to make a push. Hole 14 makes it a little more difficult for me personally, though. 413 feet straight down this gap for 390 of it, and then just barely finish off to the left. It does play slightly uphill, and there's usually a swirling head to left, to right, to right, to left.
One of the toughest wins in disc golf. Have you ever thought roller on this hole at all?
I did try a roller in the skins match that's going to come out here pretty soon, so check that out.
And really not
much better I could do there.
Yeah, not a terrible shot at all. You do have a circle two look for birdie.
Yeah, about 50 feet or so. That's all I was looking for without a tree kick, so good stuff.
If only you could have just gone giant hyzer over the left side. One can dream. Taylor fades out a little bit too left. Should be a pretty simple up and down.
Scott gets this moving just a little bit too far right, catches that last tree.
I can see the exact line he's trying to throw here. He wants that little tiny pop up to flat while still trying to creep back to the left.
Yeah, if that would have came out and had just a little bit of nose up, it would have gotten a good flare up
there.
Yeah,
might have just been a height thing. Yeah, just didn't throw it high enough.
Dan, a little bit of early release there. Not able to fight through the trees.
Ooh, shorted it. Okay, not terrible.
Not too bad. He's about 25. Taylor with a long look here. He's got a lot of spin on his wrist.
Wow. Yeah, that was floaty.
Speaking of floaty, here's another nice little floater. Great line, just not quite enough on it.
And we have your birdie look for a turkey.
I'm trying to channel that putt I was feeling on hole 8 for par. Don't quite get it though. I had the height, but I pulled it off to the left side. Strange miss for me. It happens though.
That it does. Dan cashes his putt for par. It's a beautiful day for disc golf out here in North Carolina.
Yeah, not too hot. Still a little bit humid. Not too breezy, but the fall weather's coming in. It cools off at night, and it is beautiful in North Carolina in the fall.
Yeah, I will say that that is my favorite season in North Carolina is fall. It's picture perfect.
The XT Nova. It taught me how to throw smooth, clean lines, but it also taught me how to build trust in my disc. I can put it on any line and it will hold it. I know when I throw it, it's gonna stick right there. I feel like it's very unique, and it kind of reminds me, like, nobody's ever the same. That's what I love about it. It stands out. And for me as a person, I like to stand out.
Hole 15, 551 feet. We've got another gap to hit here. There is a righty hyzer gap off to the right side if you don't feel like throwing as far. And then we dogleg off to the left to this elevated pin. Another, if you get your distance off of the tee, then it's a fairly simple upshot.
And you're just going straight. Looked like you took a little bit off of it.
Yeah, there's a pretty strong right to left wind that we're dealing with here. That was a TL3. Able to get it out through that first gap and drift off to the left side a little bit. I won't have a straight look at the pin, but it is open for a turnover shot. Yeah. Taylor, however, will have a straight look at the pin. He's gotten up to that top of the hill. Be around 230, 240 feet or so.
and Scott's thrown a decent line as well. He should have a hyzer to the basket.
Yeah, it came out just a little bit low, but traveled far enough he won't be out of position.
And Dan's thrown this a bit inside. Yeah. We'll see what kind of skip he gets.
That was a great kick that he got off to the right. Mm. That kept him from being really pinched off. Now he has a chance to throw a hyzer up to the green.
This is going to be a big shot.
And saws it off a bit. He'll be in pretty easy position to get a par there, but not in birdie position anymore.
Looks like you're going mid-range.
Yeah, Mako 3. I didn't quite get that right, but it's inside the circle. Scott got this one pretty right. Tosses it up there. He'll have a pretty easy tap-in for his birdie. Same for Taylor. Nice, easy touch forehand up to the pin.
This is the second pretty big backhand flub that we've seen Dan have, and he's kind of stalled out for a little bit. He had his hot start, and now we started taking some pars.
Yeah, this will be his fourth par in a row now. Still leading the card.
And that is a fantastic birdie putt from Circle's Edge.
That one felt pretty good. I had missed a similar putt on hole 3 earlier in the round. Felt good to correct on that.
And you're now only one stroke off Dan. Just like that.
Yeah, and Taylor and Scott going to be gaining a stroke on him as well.
Your entire card is just slowly creeping up on this back stretch.
And this is one of the par fours you really do feel like you want to get. It's got that tight gap off of the tee, but nothing that you haven't thrown for the rest of the round. So one of the ones you want to get for sure. And that moves us into hole 16, 288 feet. Another blind shot up and over this hill here. You want to throw something floaty and get it to float just around that tree and just drop inside the circle. Historically, I don't throw this shot well.
So what are you trying here? Are you going hyzer flip out of the hand, or are you throwing pure anhyzer?
I was trying to go slight hyzer flip. I just threw pure anhyzer.
What is it that feels so challenging about that specific shot?
Nothing. I just get this one wrong.
And that is the mindset you really need to have. I was testing you, Nathan. And Taylor throws a little bit long, but still a beautiful shot. Let's take a look at Taylor's throw. Don't get to see a lot of him, but I really like the way he throws the disc. He has good body positioning. He kind of does a similar thing that Dan Hastings does. Extends on a pretty steep hyzer. He starts with the disc this way, tilts it all the way on the other side. But still, compact, beautiful form. Kind of characteristic of North Carolina players.
Yeah, that hyzer stand-up release.
Yeah, very compact, very smooth. Scott Conway, another example of that type of a player.
Yeah, he's been working this last year and a half or so to kind of get a swoop that he had out, and he's done that very well.
Yeah, it looks fantastic. You know exactly what line he's throwing the moment he extends. And that's right there.
Yeah, those three bushes you see there are new this year. He squeaks just past them. They'll be a little bigger, I imagine, next year.
And it's so interesting you're talking about a swoop. A lot of players who play in the woods to have a little bit of a swoop because you throw with a little bit of nose up to stall the disc a little bit more.
And Dan has turned this one over a little bit too. Another kind of backhand mistake there.
And you got a long look to get some revenge on this hole. Little spinner. Oh, just in front of the basket. See, I don't know what happens this round. So.
Yeah, I gave that one a decent chance. It came up just a bit short. Yeah. But it's frustrating to be that far away on this hole in the first place. It's really pretty easy.
And a gorgeous putt from Taylor. That's going to be a birdie for him.
Catching back up. That puts him at six down as well, just one behind Dan.
He's had a bit of a roller coaster round, too. Had a bit of a valley in the middle stretch, and now he's coming right back.
Yeah, a couple bogeys in a row on 7 and 8, but he's bounced back well. And Scott, after having those 9, maybe 10 pars in a row, is starting to put those birdies together, and those no bogeys are showing he's catching right back up.
Yeah, it's awesome to see. You know, we all know how it feels to just feel like you're going to sleep after taking that many pars in a row, but he hasn't taken a bogey yet, so he's staying in there.
Dan with the par cleanup, looking to get back on track, just 2 holes left. Hole 17, another change from last year, 371 feet. We've got a longer tee pad, kind of opens up this left side for a bigger lefty hyzer shot or a righty forehand. There is a righty backhand flex shot on the right side, but it's much more technical. Don't go too long. There's OB behind it as well.
Surprise. Little claw grip on the forehand. Good camera angle there.
And again, just that little one step and huge snap with the wrist.
Oh, and he just catches one of those last trees. He's still putting from a decent distance.
Yeah, he's inside the circle there. Scott gonna take this technical right side.
Ooh.
And he doesn't quite get as much right as you want on that shot, but he does pass through there clean, and he'll be in circle 2 and has a birdie look.
That's flipping up nicely and sticks it within 15 feet. We're going to check out your throw, Nathan. And compared to how you used to throw when you just got into disc golf, what do you feel proud of in your throw now?
I have a lot more control in it. You can see that every movement that I had there was planned, and that last pull through right at the end was all I was looking for.
It's got to feel good. No wasted motion. You kind of have the quintessential Charlotte or, you know, North Carolina disc golf throw. Ooh, a nasty ground play. Luckily, he gets...
All right, so I saw 2 things that I was correct about that I didn't realize on... I thought my shot was short, and I wasn't sure why it got there. It looks like I skipped through the trees. I thought Dan's shot didn't have enough angle to get the skip up there and be close, and I was also correct. He got a very nice roll to put him inside the circle.
Oh, no.
That's about the 4th time, I think, that we've seen Scott hit the band this round.
And he's shaking his head. He knows he's doing everything he can right now, and hitting the band just feels, after a certain point, feels terrible.
The first couple times, you're like, all right, I gave it a chance. I didn't miss low, but once you keep doing it...
It's like it's 3 inches thick. Like, the chains are a foot, over a foot wide.
And Taylor kind of... squeaks his putt low left side, but able to get another birdie to put him to 7 down. Dan gonna try to match to stay a stroke ahead.
And he gets the birdie, moves to 8 under. And his par train is over. This is your opportunity to snag a birdie as well. Cash.
Yeah, three birdies on 17. Pretty good. Pretty solid score for this hole. Scott tapping in the par. That leaves us just one hole left. Hole 18, yet another basket that has been lengthened 354 feet. We used to dump off to the left side here over in that early tree line. Now they've straightened it off and made it a bit longer. You've got this OB cart path that comes into play, or sidewalk that comes into play on the right side. Throw it about as straight as you can.
Yeah, and it makes the righty backhand actually a little bit tough. The forehand seems to be a little bit safer play. And Taylor throws a decent shot. He's going to be putting at the basket, still decent distance.
Yeah, starting to push that sidewalk, but stays in bounds.
So, luckily, you get to try to make a correction on his line.
Yeah, I'm going TL3 here, and I just throw it at the ground. Fun stuff.
Probably the least fun thing you could do, especially after battling back.
I know, I've been fighting to finish this whole round strong, been doing pretty well, and then on the last tee shot, just don't even give myself the birdie look. And Dan going with the flex shot. There's some trees over here on the left, but if you miss them, you can curl right back around.
Wow, and he's 15 feet from the basket to shoot a 9 under par. And we're just going to have to see where Joel Freeman ended up.
And Scott's got the ideal line here, just throwing straight at it.
You got to hand it to Scott, honestly. What a round. He's going to be done with this round and want to take a nap.
Oh, and I was trying to give that one a run. Now I'm circle's edge here for par.
And he drains it.
All right. Didn't finish with a bogey. Felt pretty good to at least not get that bogey on the last hole after that upshot.
And 7 under par doesn't put you in a terrible spot.
Yeah, I fought back to keep myself in it. We've got Taylor here going for 4 birdies in a row to finish. Able to connect to shoot 8 under par. What a bounce back for him after that rough couple holes in the middle of the round. Dan Hastings, after a stretch of 4 or 5 pars in the middle, gonna finish with 2 birdies to maintain his strong round, finish with a 9 under and win the card. Scott with a bogey-free 6 down, 5 of those coming on the back nine. Great bounce back for him on this back nine.
That ended up being a surprisingly good finish for your card.
Yeah, finished with the small straight, 9, 8, 7, 6.
And there you have it, the small straight. Cross it off on your Yahtzee scorecard. And we will take a look at this leaderboard. And Joel Freeman dropping a stroke to 9 under. He's gonna tie Corey Ellis and Dan Hastings. And we'll be joined by AJ Carey on the lead card going into round number 2.
Yeah, round 2 will be at Farmville, so make sure you tune into that.
Make sure to subscribe to Gatekeeper Media. We will see you next time. I'm Brian Earhart. He is Nathan Queen. We are signing off.
We'll see you guys out there.